Who knows the quote, "There is no there there"? Who can tell me who said that? Gertrude Stein. What was she talking about? Oakland. There is no there there. The same can be said about becoming a travel writer. I think, I'm sure there are at least a few in the room who thought, I want to find out how to be a travel writer. Well, there's no there there. There's no such job. There's no job fair. There's nobody looking to hire a new travel writer full-time, going to make your living. And I'm here to dispel your myths. Whatever you think it may be, it isn't. There is no sitting under a palm tree with a notebook, waxing poetic about the breeze and the tropical rain. It doesn't exist. Online publishing has really decimated the field, and everybody wants free content now. So there's diminishing returns for those who already are in the field. It's not what it was 20 years ago. It's not what it was even 10 years ago or even 5 years ago. Publishers are still trying to figure out how to make money in an ever-shrinking market. There are publishers such as Lonely Planet who have a growing market share in, say, America. I think Lonely Planet remains, though now an American company, they were for a long time, an Australian company, and they were, and I believe still are, the largest publisher of English language travel books in the world. And though they have an expanding market in America, the overall travel publishing market is shrinking. So what has travel writing become? It's no longer about long-form prose. If you open magazines, you don't see long travel articles. You don't see a lot of prose. It's about curated lists by experts, theoretically, experts in big quotation marks, curated lists by experts in a field, top tens, listicles. You see these things all the time. Top 10 best beach vacations, you know, top 100 hotels. You know, Condé Nast is always out with its hot 100 list. So the work that they want, those publishers who are hiring, they want dense paragraphs. If anything, they want 50 words, they want 100 words or 30 words, but they want dense, punchy paragraphs. So you can't say, you have to be really tight with the way you word things. Every word has to count. Assignments now pay pennies on the dollar compared to what they used to, because now they want another air quotes, writer to fill in templates. Writers now are very often just filling in data. They're data monkeys, transporting, you know, information from one thing to another thing, creating listicles, and you don't leave your desk a lot of the time if you're really a contemporary travel writer. There's less travel in travel writing than there used to be. This is the current state of travel publishing. Now, that's not true for everybody. There are still glamorous assignments, and there's still great magazine jobs, but they're fewer and fewer, and they're harder and harder to come by. So you understand the difference between market share and market that I just explained? That all made sense to you? Okay, that's super important to understand. Magazine writing is now largely driven by PR people. Please come in. There's room, I'm sure. We can make, Brian will help you find space to sit, gentlemen. Magazine writing is now largely PR driven. There were a few up until, I think Condé Nast may have been in the last holdout that financed its authors and its writers to go out into the field and dine or sail or whatever it was they were writing about. But now they don't do that. Now they take comps too. Everybody, Lonely Planet, they don't allow comps. More quotes, but what is a comp? A comp is, you know, when I say something is a comp, it's free. And this is the question, how do you finance travel writing? Who pays for it? A lot of travel writing is now funded by PR people, PR agencies, local municipalities. For example, Visit San Francisco has huge budgets to fly in a travel writer. I forget what the CVB is called now. What's it called? Visit San Francisco? No, it's called Only in San Francisco. That's it. Only in San Francisco dot travel. That is the official agency of travel for the city of San Francisco. The official agency for the state of California is Visit California, visitcalifornia.com. Every municipality, state, country has its own tourism agency. And in other countries, they're really big fields. You can study tourism, for example, in France and become a tourism professional and work in tourism development. Here, it's more hodgepodge. It's people mostly from PR backgrounds and marketing. And so marketing people are now in a lot, travel writing has in many ways become what food writing had already become. If you look at what restaurants are popular in San Francisco, they're the ones that, ooh, I want to go to that place, I read about that place. Ooh, that one's famous. Ooh, that one's in Michelin. Why is it famous? Why is it covered? Why is it in Michelin? Because there's a huge PR company, or they're paying a powerful PR company to get their name out there. They're not necessarily the best chefs, they're not necessarily the best food, but they're the most famous and the most covered, and that's where the dollars go, and that's what this is about. It's about where the money goes. So how do you underwrite a profession nobody wants to pay for? You get municipalities to cover airfares. If I call San Francisco and say, I'm coming from Seattle, I live in Seattle, and I'm covering San Francisco for such and such magazine or such and such book, if I have enough line space or if I have enough readers, the first question is always going to be, how many readers, how many column inches, how many pages? And then you get into this very delicate business of, well, what are you, they'll say, well, we'll cover your airfare if you can mention the airline. We'll cover your hotel if you can mention the hotel. Well, you may have in your idea, in your head, that you want to go to San Francisco and find the best hotel for your readers. So you have to know how to deal with PR people. If you really do get into this, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but the magic words you say to any PR person, if you're ever confronted with a PR person, is thank you very much, I'm grateful for your assistance. However, you must understand that anything you offer is for editorial consideration only. That's how you keep from becoming a whore. Okay? Memorize that line. Anything you offer me is for editorial consideration only. If it's a fit for my readers, I'm happy to give it coverage, but I cannot guarantee coverage in advance. Now, most magazines will guarantee coverage in advance too. Hotels, airlines, providers of services. You know how when you watch Jeopardy or all those shows, travel furnished by and promotional consideration provided by American Airlines. That slate of the plane in the American Airlines ad is because American Airlines flies the contestants to Chicago for free or wherever they're going in exchange for that slate. So Jeopardy or whatever TV broadcaster, come in, I'm sure there's plenty of room. I'm sure there's a seat. Where's the seat? There's a seat. Yeah, there. Okay, great. Welcome. Anyway, this whole business of this, and this is about maintaining editorial integrity. How, if you want to speak about a destination in clear, frank terms, how are you going to do that? Who's the publisher you're going to fit with? Well, this is complicated. Let's not worry about that right now. Let's worry about how do you get a toehold in the field. You're never going to get a job solely as a travel writer, okay? And if you do, you're going to hustle, hustle, hustle. You're going to work 60, 80 hours a week. You're going to work for way less than minimum wage. But you'll live a life of subsidized luxury. You'll be flown here, maybe, if you're lucky. You'll have to cover many of your own expenses, unless you're writing for magazines, in which case the PR firms and the municipalities cover costs. But it's not what it appears to be. It's not what you think. So I, for example, I don't really do much travel anymore because there's so much. I don't want to be a whore for the municipalities or for the magazine that has something they want to say because they know they want to cover Rio, so they got this free thing and this free thing, and the person who goes to cover it is basically just filling in the free things that were offered. It's not necessarily the best thing to do. So if you really want to have your own independent, strong voice, there are fewer and fewer publishers who allow that. But you can always do that with blogging. You can do it with your own website. You can create your own brand. And here's where you have to stand out now. If you really want to get into this field, you have to have more than just writing. Nobody reads anymore. People don't read. I know you're here. I know we're in the library. I know that's heresy to say. But people don't read the way they used to. They scan. So it's really important. You have to be a writer, a blogger, and now a video journalist. Now, video journalism, it's the future. Video is the future. As we live in a world of ever-decreasing attention spans, did I say that? Yeah, attention spans. People, they don't want to read. They want to see the video. They want to, you know, even instructions for how to get benefits from Social Security. They say, to understand how to fill out the form, watch this video, not just read this page. So if you can learn video journalism, which is a very specific branch of video, it's about telling a story with simple frames. And you can do it as a one-man thing. There actually is a really great, if you have some extra money and have some extra time, the thing that I would suggest to do is to study with Rosenblum TV in New York or London. There's a three-day crash course. It's called Video Journalism Boot Camp, I think. And it's about $2,200. And you have to find lodging in New York, and you have to get your butt to New York. But you will learn how to shoot, edit, and deliver broadcast quality video using your iPhone. Oh, my iPhone's not in my pocket. If you have an iPhone 6 or better, you have a broadcast quality high definition camera in your pocket. It's a super powerful tool. Yes?
Just a quick question. I do have an iPhone 6S, and I've taken some videos.
That?
So what is there to learn further from Rosenblum?
Well, hold on.
Most sites would just take a very short video anyway, just a few seconds, maybe a minute at most. So what is, it's not like...
Video, okay. How much do you think travel writing pays from a magazine? It's not changed in 25 years. What do you guess? Per word. It pays by word. What do you think? For a magazine. It was $1 a word. And it hasn't changed in 25 friggin' years. But it should be, Forbes used to pay up to $5 a word. But that's, you know, that's really good. The $5 a word assignments are over. They don't exist anymore. They're $1 and maybe $2 a word assignments. But a good paying job is $1 a word. Online publishing, if you're lucky, you get 20 cents a word. It's more like $20 for a 200 or 300 word article. It's just not worth it. So it's like scabs and union employees, like people saying, oh, I'll do it, I want to be a travel writer, coming in and sawing the legs off the people who really know what they're doing. So what do you think publishers will pay for video per minute? $1,000. Not travel publishers, but in general, you know, a one-minute video will perfectly produced. There can be no flaws of sound. There can be no moving camera. There can be no fuzzy mic in the frame. But if you learn to shoot and broadcast and deliver professional-grade material, it's $1,000 per finished minute. And the Rosenblums, Lisa Lander and Michael Rosenblum, really teach you how to do this. I don't want to make this a commercial for them. But I took their class because they're on the board of the company that now owns Lonely Planet. So I had this that's how I heard about them in the first place. And my mother lives in New York, and I was in New York, and I just happened to do it. Anyway, but it's quite fabulous, and you will really learn how to shoot and edit and deliver broadcast quality video. But you have to know how to tell a story. If you don't know how to tell a story, now we're back to writing. And here's why it's always good to begin with writing, because if you know how to write, you can tell a story. There has to be an arc of a narrative in writing, in video. However, whatever story you're telling, there has to be a beginning, a middle, and an end. You can't just sort of go here and there. And so what is travel writing ultimately? What is it? Let's talk about what, in its purest form, travel writing is. Please come in, sir. Travel writers are folklorists. This is, after doing this for almost 15 years or more, that's really what travel writing is. You're a folklorist. You're freeze-framing a culture in a specific moment in time. What are people eating? What are they doing for entertainment? Where are they sleeping? How do they sleep? What do they do for festivals? How do they celebrate? What are their sacred days? And this is always in flux. Cultures are always in flux. And travel writing, therefore, is extremely perishable, which is another reason publishers don't want to pay top dollar for something that's not going to be valid a year from now. The restaurant landscape changes. The nightclubs change so fast. It's a nightmare to cover bars and nightclubs because as soon as it's published, because paper publishing has a 9-month lead time, 9 to 12 month lead time. So what I'm researching, say now, if I were turning in work right now, I do the San Francisco book for Lonely Planet, for example. If it were publishing next March, I would be turning in the work coming up in these next couple weeks, these next 4, 6, 8, 10 weeks. And because it has to go to editing, and then it has to go to layout, and then it has to go to design, and then it has to be printed, and then it has to be packaged, it has to be shipped, and all this stuff takes a tremendous amount of time. So just understand what you're doing if you're a travel writer. You're a folklorist. So the lens through which you look at this task is sort of anthropological. And these sort of noble viewpoints help you in the work when you are faced with PR people and editors who are just out of college and don't know anything about the subject matter you're covering, or and are trying to speed through the data and cutting out the most important stuff that you've submitted and say, why am I doing this? So you have to have some sort of higher-minded drivers in your head propelling you and keeping your heart pure and alive. So as far as I can tell, being a folklorist is the most helpful, because it's a special role to be able to see through that lens, because none of us really notice anything changing. But when you see how slippery life is, I don't want to get too caught up in philosophy, but it's a helpful view. You have to have a few strong philosophical things anchoring you to who you are. Otherwise, you're just a whore for the PR people. Don't be a whore for the PR people. Remember that. I'm not a whore for the PR people. This is for editorial consideration only. I'll gladly accept what you're offering. Thank you so much, but it's for editorial consideration only. Okay, how do I get started? How do you get started? First, you have to find your voice. Everybody has a voice. Everybody has a story in them. Everybody knows something different. Everybody's got a different view on life. So the only secret to writing is to write. So you must write. This is what you do. But you have to have good mechanics. So if you've never studied grammar, now is the time. It's very important to have good grammar. Even if publishers aren't necessarily paying attention to that, even what you read online sucks and says, you know, it's full of cliches, you must have excellent grammar and excellent mechanics with the language. That's every little thing that can put you ahead matters, because there's such competition. And to be able to write with color and flair and texture. A really great exercise, there's something called Morning Pages. There's a book called The Artist's Way, which is a very good book. It comes down to two basic things, really, that you do every day and every week. The first thing is get up every morning and write longhand 10 minutes. Just write longhand 10 minutes. If you can't think of what to write, write your name. Say, I can't think of what to write. But you never move backwards on the page. You never correct. You never say, oh, I should have said that. Then just write a new line. I just wrote that, but I meant to say this. And just keep writing for it. It's about pushing the pen. It's about hand-eye-brain connection. So you're doing this. Don't type it. You can't type it. You got to write it longhand. 10 minutes. And then when you're done, you're done. Throw it out. Burn it. Save it. Have a ritual. Whatever you want. Doesn't matter. The exercise is the exercise. And you will find, in very short order, that this unlocks your ability to create on the page, or to think in broader terms, or to assemble ideas. It's as if by magic. This really works so well. It's the most potent thing I know. And whenever I'm stuck or have writer's block, this is the exercise that I always go to, and it works really fast. So every morning, first thing, before you eat, shower, and you might, okay, have some coffee if you want, but immediately, no reading, no TV, no computer, longhand writing first, 10 minutes. next, you must know your talents. What are you good at? I got hired by Lonely Planet and by Photos in the beginning because I had a background in luxury travel. I had worked as a 5-star hotel concierge, and I had studied cooking in Paris. So I had all this food and hotels background. And they were interested in that because most of their writers hadn't any of that knowledge. So they were glad to have someone who could walk into a 5-star hotel and understand what distinguished one from another. So that was my toehold in the industry. It remains so, because a lot of people say, well, I don't know, what's the difference between business class and first class? Well, there's a very big difference. But not everybody knows. Even the passengers on the airplane or in the hotel don't know. But the answer to that question, the difference between business and first class, business class gives you everything, gives you a list of amenities. There you go. First class looks at you, and before you even ask for anything, they size you up, and they say, oh, she has wet shoes. I bet she wants slippers. So you show up with beautiful silk slippers and say, hi, I noticed your shoes were wet. I'm sure you might find these more comfortable as we sit on this airplane for 12 hours, and give you slippers before you ask. It's anticipating what someone wants before they know they want it. That's first class. Business class is the list of amenities. Yes, they have slippers. Yes, they have umbrellas, but they don't hand them to you because it's raining out. So anyway, I'm sidetracked. So what is your talent? Surely you must know something that's marketable in the travel industry. Hi, welcome. Come on in. Hey, are you? Hey, good to see you. And then you really need to start a blog. And not a meandering blog. Travel writing is not journaling. You're not saying, oh, I woke up this morning, I drank orange juice, click, bye-bye. Nobody wants that. Be, what's the word? Astute. You want to say something that's fresh, dynamic, new. You don't have to struggle. You just look around town. There's always something to talk about in San Francisco. It could be homelessness. It could be, I walked in the library and this guy said, hey, man, how you doing? I said, hi, I'm sorry, I'm on my way somewhere. I thought he was going to ask me for money. And he said, no, I'm not going to ask you for money. Actually, I was wondering if you wanted some acid. And I was like, oh, that's a first. Okay, I like that. This is different. I could write about that, a few sentences about walking to the public library to give a lecture and somebody tries to sell me acid. That's funny. You all laughed. So your blog should be, yeah, if you're going to write about San Francisco or, you know, you want to write about something topical and timely, blogs, you just kind of churn them out. But I would say, because if you want to be a true writer, you're not going to have typos. You're going to reread it and you're going to proof it. And after you post it, if you catch an error, you're going to correct it. You must be impeccable with your word. Everything must be super tight. If you're really going to frame yourself as a writer and actually be a writer, you must be super tight, above everybody else. Blogging, you can look at WordPress. This is all done with WordPress. I hired somebody to get this layout, to get this template. I like the slideshow. It's nice. It's good for people who just like to zip through things. But there is content. There's tons of content here if you dig around. But you have to go through it. You have to go to blogs and cycle through it. And I won't bore you with looking online right now. But I like that it cycles through and you can be sort of grab someone with an image and have a lead line. All right. So you can also get into editorial by taking an editorial job, but there are fewer and fewer of those. If you've noticed, there are fewer and fewer editors in the world. Content just gets posted. You submit the content, and whatever content provider posts it. They don't even read it. They don't proof it. Mistakes are constantly posted. That's why you have to be your own editor. You have to be your own fact checker. And it's really, really hard to write. Molly Ivan said that the only thing harder than writing is coal mining. I think she's right. But you have to hold yourself to the task because no one else will. And if you don't make yourself better than everybody else, you'll never get anywhere in this. Which leads me to the importance of style. Nothing will make an editor happy than clean copy. Because if they get the copy and say, oh my God, this is disastrous, but I don't have time to do anything with it, they have to post it because there are no more editors like there used to be. And the editor thinks, Jesus, that looks terrible. And I'm never going to hire that person again. It happens all the time. People get these one-off jobs. That's why you don't see consistent bylines, because there's so many bad writers and so much bad writing. I spent a ton of time on my first assignments. They were really short and really easy, but I just spent so much time laboring over every detail. And lo and behold, I got hired again. You should do the same. You should also read work by writers that you like. And read, if you want to write for particular periodicals, you should be reading those. Don't just think I'm going to write for them without reading them. You may think that's surprising, but lots of people do that. They say, oh, I want to write for Food and Wine without ever having picked up a copy. If you don't have a favorite writer, pick up a copy of Best American Travel Writing. That's prose. That's long-form prose that nobody wants to buy, but by established authors. But at least it gives you an idea of how to talk about place. Because it's hard to talk about place. You need an inroad. You need a lens. You need an angle. And remember the primary rule of writing. Show it, don't say it. Don't say, it was a beautiful day. Say, the fog broke early. The sky was blue. There was no fog. The beach, which is normally empty, was full of people. Something like that. You demonstrate it. You show it. You don't say it. Don't just say, it's beautiful, because it's empty. It doesn't mean anything. How is it beautiful? Why is it beautiful? Show it. Don't say it. And use all five senses. This is really important with travel writing, particularly so because people want to place themselves. You're the proxy. There's, you know, a lot of people who read travel writing who actually never go anywhere, but they just want to know what it's like in Timbuktu or wherever. They want to read about it because they want to place themselves. So you must use your senses in your writing. And a good exercise to do this is go to the Ferry Building or go to the Civic Center Market right outside. What's it called? The Farmer's Market, I forget the name, downstairs on, what is it, Wednesday and Sunday. And just walk around and describe the scene, you know, the people pushing each other, jostling, or the flower salesman, or the, you know, the drunk beer guy, or whatever. And write about it with your senses, what it smells like, what it tastes like, what it looks like, what you hear, and what you touch. Always, always, always avoid cliches. Do you know what a cliche is? We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Any phrase you've heard before that's been used. Don't use any language anybody's ever heard before. And I have a list from I can't really say what publisher it's from, but it's proprietary. It's an international publisher. It's not Lonely Planet, but it's a name you all know, and it's a name known worldwide. And here is their banned list of things you can't say if you write for their magazine. Avoid tired, stock phrases that you'd never actually use anywhere other than in travel writing. Also, avoid trying too hard and purple prose, which is a British thing. Anyway, our favorite phrases to avoid are, number one, foodie. Two, blank lovers, like a food lover's guide or an art lover's. Referring to people as if they're defined by one thing. Urbanites will love. Referring to the reader as a potential tourist. Quote, visitors will find XYZ. Referring to travelers. Most travelers bypass and travel in general. While this approach is practical, the writer should be writing should be about the places and people in front of you, not how they might be viewed by a visitor or a third person. Does that make sense? You don't want to say, the visitor will see, or the you get that? You just say, second person always works well. You will see, because you're talking to someone, potentially. Although certain publishers don't like you to use the second person either. And nobody likes you to use the first person. And that's the first person, for those of you who don't know, is speaking in I. So much blogging is always in I. It's always in the first person, because there's a blogger. But why should we care? There's someone I know who I met once at a cocktail party, and she found out that I did travel writing. She's like, oh my God, I love you. I want to meet you for coffee. It's like, okay, I'll meet you for coffee. And I met you at a dinner party, and you're a friend of a friend. Well, I met her once for coffee. I met her at a dinner party, and she's been traveling around the globe and keeps sending me like these 500 to 1,500 word first-person essays. And she's a really nice person in person, but I don't know anything about her, and why should I care? This is the question. When someone is saying, I, why do I need to know who you are? Can't you tell me about Carmel without telling me who you are? Unless, of course, you're this funny person who goes to places and dances, and you were trying to dance on the cobblestones in Carmel, and you fell, and you got a ticket for wearing heels, or whatever it is, because they do that in Carmel. Then it's funny. Then you need to know the I. But otherwise, avoid the first person. It's really slippery slope. Back to this list. I'll just zip through it. Quirky. A blank for the senses, an assault on the senses, must see, a blank's paradise, like a shopper's paradise, trendy or funky, we're loving blank, blank has it all, a blank of contrasts, eye-opening, oh-so, although oh-so can be fun. Like, I like oh-so. Oh-so has its place if you're saying something like, it was oh so over the top queer that the leather queens had high heels on. Something like that, where you're a little playful and like setting something up. Spurious references to celebrities, like, we heard Kate Moss had recovered from a facelift at such and such a hotel. Don't ever talk like that, it's tacky. Nobody wants to hear that. Alliteration, you know, where you repeat certain consonants. A doggy diner dingo, whatever, you know, avoid alliteration. Good for the soul, mouth-watering, awe-inspiring, a blank to remember, fresh, comfy, spotless, referring to food as tasty, a gem, particularly a hidden gem. Boast, my personal favorite to hate. If the thing doing the boasting is an inanimate object, e.g., the hotel boasts a pool and spa, it cannot be so. Okay? Nothing boasts. Only people boast. And writers who say boast are trying to boast. And it's, don't do it. Ooze. The hotel oozes charm. Hotels don't ooze. Sores ooze. Pus oozes. Award-winning. Another one. Award-winning is meaningless on its own because what's the award they won? And even if you cite the award, if it's some obscure award, it's not relevant to the reader. Remember, you have very few words and every word counts. Referring to fare instead of food. Achingly, an achingly hip, culture vulture, or the, underline, the place for blank to be seen. The, or chic when used excessively. Shabby chic, boutique chic, etc. Adrenaline junkie. Default adjectives like lush for any type of verdant landscape, sleek for modern architecture, cozy for pubs, bustling for markets. You get it? Default adjectives. Airy, and then think when asking a reader to imagine a place, like think sleek architecture. So that's from a famous publisher that was attached to an assignment I had recently. And I thought you would like to know this. So avoid cliches. I've spoken too much about cliches, but I can't overemphasize it enough. Don't write in cliches. And most everything you will read that somebody's been paid for is packed with cliches. Don't fall into that trap, because they probably won't really get anywhere in their career, and the publisher probably knows it sucks, but they had to post it because they paid the person, and they had a day to get it in. Don't let this happen. Okay, so where were we? Whenever possible, speak in the active voice, not the passive voice. Think of these two sentences. Memorize these two sentences. The barn was struck by lightning. Lightning struck the barn. Passive, active. We speak a lot in the passive voice. Conversation is passive, but in written language, you must be active as much as possible. Active has its place, especially when you're trying to avoid responsibility. Mistakes were made versus George Bush made mistakes. Get it? Mistakes were made by George Bush is still passive, but such and such made mistakes. I made a mistake. Saying mistakes were made is an evasion. So you use the passive voice to evade. So if you want to be clever and you're showing underlining evasion, then you can use the passive voice and then you're sort of giving a double entendre for the educated reader. But get good reference books and use them. If you don't have any reference book, the easiest one to get and the easiest one you can carry in your bag is The Elements of Style. It's whatever, 100 years old or 50 years old, and it's fabulous. It's still got all the basics of how to use a comma, how to use a semicolon, what's a comma splice. Super simple. You can read through it. And there's a new edition that has pictures in it that's really great. I can't remember who it was done with. You know that Elements of Style with the drawings? I'm sure it's in the library here. The Elements of Style by Strunk and White, and there's a new edition that has drawings to accompany the text that are really quite fabulous. Check your facts, because publishers don't check facts, but if you, they used to, but they don't have the staff anymore because they don't have the money because of shrinking budgets and shrinking market share. So you have to turn in factually correct work. So that means if you make any claim whatsoever, 500-room hotel, you pick up the telephone and you call the hotel. Yes, the telephone is faster than email usually. How many rooms are in your hotel? Well, we have 497. How many are suites? 32. How many actual standard bedrooms do you have? And you have to break it down. You have to be very clear. When you make a claim in print, you're making a claim in print. So if there's a problem, libel laws in America are different from anywhere else in the world, because we have the First Amendment. What do they call that? When you accuse someone of, there's libel, if Slander, libel and slander. If you accuse someone of slander in America, only in America is the burden of proof on the accuser. That means you say to me, you called me blank. You have to prove that I did that. And it's not up to me. I just wrote it. Every other country in the world, except for America, the burden of proof is on the accused. That's to say, if I write Donald Trump XYZ, Donald Trump sues me. It's not up to Donald Trump to prove it. It's up to me to prove that I didn't do. So you have to prove a negative, which is all but impossible. So those, hi, welcome. Come on in this room. Those cases are always settled out of court overseas because there's just no way to prove a negative. So just the same, it's and a lot of publishers are overseas. You know, they could be owned by a conglomerate that's based in Germany. I think Random House, last I knew, had been owned by a German company. I don't know if they still are. And Photos is owned by Random House, if they still are. So you may be writing for a German conglomerate, and if you put something in that's libelous or slanderous or factually incorrect, you're in trouble. And they may not indemnify you. That's always in a contract. They always have indemnification for the publisher, but most people who get a travel writing contract just get the contract and sign it, and you should never, ever do that. You should never, ever do that. There are lawyers for the arts. You can have review it. Welcome. Hi. And you should always make, on this, I won't get into contracts, but you should always make indemnification mutual. If you ever sign a contract that has an indemnification clause, it should be mutual so that you're both off the hook. That's very important. And if you have the chance to write your own contract, if somebody says, well, you want to have a contract, you write the contract, you've got the edge. Let's not talk about contracts. Let's just talk with your beginners. So let's talk about beginning. Blogging. One last thing. You have to be able to tell a story. I would look up, if you really want to do this, I would learn craft. I would learn something. You know, what's that great book? On Writing, I think. It talks about writing. And is that what it's called? On Writing? Famous. Yeah. On Writing Well. Yeah. Thank you. Anything that's got anything that's about craft and teaching you how to tell a good story, you should definitely learn to tell a story. Otherwise, you're kind of, it's not going to work. Blogging, because you will have to blog. You didn't have to 10 years ago, but you do have to now. You should have a blog that's your own name. See, johnvlahides.com. If your name is Bob Smith, I'm sorry. But find, you know, Bob Smith Writer or something like that. But it's good to have a proprietary website that's your name. It should be your name, not like Itchy Feet. I mean, a lot of people do that because they're trying to create a brand. But if you're, it's better to have a proprietary name site so you can people can see your portfolio, because that's what they want to look up, your portfolio. When you write a blog post, it's good to answer something that people may not have thought about that's in your chosen field. Like, I know about travel and luxury travel, and I was on this business class flight, dinner flight, wherever it is there, that one. I blacked out on an airplane. It's a long story. It's really funny, and I only know about it because I had just gotten a new iPhone. It's like 5 or 6 years ago when they first came out, whatever it was. And I had it in my pocket, and it fell out of my pocket, and the flight attendant picked it up and said, oh, does this have a camera? And I was only in a blackout because the flight attendant insisted I stay awake because she figured out that I was a travel writer. And she said, I want to talk to you after my service. It was an empty plane, and I won't go into too much detail, but she said, after my service, I'm going to come and get you, and I want you to come to the galley and just talk to me about travel writing. I said, okay, but come and get me before I take my sleeping pills. And she said, oh, no, I'll be back. So she never appears. I watch a movie. I eat my dinner, and I brush my teeth. And I lie down, and I'm about to go to sleep. And she comes running back. I said, oh, I just took my sleeping pill. And she said, that's okay. I'll give you some wine. I was like, okay. And anyway, I won't give away the story. But I only know about it because she took pictures with my phone. And I forgot about the whole thing until I got home. And it's a really funny story. So that's that. So that answers a question that immediately, as soon as I posted that, as soon as you write your little blog posts, whatever it is, you go onto Facebook, because you have to have a Facebook account, whether you like it or not, and you go onto Twitter, and you go, which you have to also have, whether you like it or not, and you don't post your story on those outlets, or it becomes their property. So what did I do on Facebook? I wrote, considering, if you have something like considering taking sleeping pills on your next long-haul flight, question mark, you better read this first, period. And then boom, next thing I know, if you Google Ambien and airplanes, not only am I the first thing that comes up, my picture is the first thing that comes up too, in a blackout. Hi, Mom. So that happened really fast, like within a few hours, like 72 hours, suddenly I'm page one of Google, and I'm there a year later. So, but when you do that, you have to search before you post something. You have to look at your title that you want to use. Search for the title you want to use. Has anybody else used it? Nobody had used that. And it's the kind of thing that's kind of catchy. It's a negative. People don't write, you know, they say, why to do blank? Very few. I mean, it's kind of catching on now, why not to? And I only had the idea because Condé Nast hired me to write a piece called Why Not To, or 10 Things Not To Do in San Francisco, and I thought it was such a good idea. It immediately came up first. So you want to search Google before you actually post anything or commit to any story title or tags, that you search for them so that you can fill a void on Google and that you can be higher in the page rank. You should write in short paragraphs online. Short, like 2 to 3 sentence paragraphs, because people scan. And if you have big blocks of text, people will read the beginning and the end, and they'll miss the entire middle. But if you break them into shorter blocks, they'll read the beginning of each block generally. So you'll have, and don't wait till the end. Front load your story. So you need a good lead line, which is another mechanical piece. The first sentence has to collar the reader and grab them. And you know what? I will open this, because we're talking about writing online, and this is online. So here's the stand first. Should one take sleeping pills on board an airplane? I examined this question in an essay. I write it lit quick. Fine. Take your own photographs, and you should watermark them, which I haven't done. You have to be a photographer, too, did I tell you that? But you have a broadcast quality camera in your pocket, so. You should watermark your photographs, because now this is on the internet, but it doesn't have my name on it, even though it's a fabulous picture that I took at SFO. So here's my lead line. I had started with something else, but I read it to a friend who's a writer, Carl Solmein, who's also read at the library. And this line was buried in the middle, and he said, no, that's your first line. 2 shots of Jack Daniels, 1 milligram of Ativan, and 10 milligrams of Ambien. You're all listening now. Aha, that's a good lead line, because said, what are you going to do with these drugs and alcohol? This was the cocktail for sleep suggested to me by a medical doctor I once met on a dinner flight from New York to San Francisco. Then into the story. And if you look at the layout of this, you can scan, and you know there's quick breaks, the conversation, then there's the pictures. I won't give away the pictures. It's really funny. You have to go see it. You have to read it. It's your homework. Okay, so that's about blogging. So don't post your story on Facebook, or it's no longer your story. It belongs to Facebook. Okay? You post a link to your story, and you post a link that can be copied by others, and be careful what pictures you post, because I'm in a blackout and there's a little kid sitting in my lap, and I posted that and BBC Travel published that worldwide. And my web person said, John, you can't have a child sitting in your lap in a blackout in the back of an airplane, sitting on the floor of the galley. I said, oh my God, why not? I guess. I think it's a really funny picture, though. And she said, you can't do that in America. I said, people, I know it's not your intention, but people will have the wrong idea. I was like, oh my God, you can't take it back. You can take it down. I put up a different picture that's equally funny. But if you Google, it's still buried in there somewhere. I'm not a child molester, but somebody could, like, you know, who knows what people think of you. So you're going onto the World Wide Web. It's not San Francisco. It's not this nice room in the library. We can make jokes about Donald Trump or sleeping pills or acid in the lobby. This is the World Wide Web. And you are talking about your worldwide reputation. So be impeccable with your word and your pictures. pitching. I'm going to give you some really quick tips on pitching. We've got about 15 minutes, and I want to plow through these because it's important. Number one, find an angle for your story. Travel writing is not journaling. I know I said that. Know the publications you want to write for. Study them cover to cover. Editors want to know how your work will fit into their publication. Who's the publication geared to? What do readers' letters indicate about the readership? How could your work enhance the material that already exists in the magazine? Suggest to the editor you pitch where in the magazine your pitch will fit. Which is to say, if you want to write a feature, you say, I'm pitching a feature. But if you're a nobody who's trying to write a feature, it's not going to happen. So you should always be pitching in the beginning for front of book. That's the terminology, front of book. Using that phrase will make it seem like you know what you're doing, and they'll be more inclined to hire you. So you can shoot for something in the front of the book. So look at the structure of the magazine. Look at the front of the book, then the features, and then the back of book. The most essential thing about pitching someone, is the three questions you have to answer in any pitch letter. Why this? Why now? Why you? Let's say you want to do something on South America. What's everyone talking about in South America now? Zika virus. So, well, I'm a woman, I'm of childbearing age, but I'm not pregnant. Should I be worried? How to, like, you know, something about women's travel to sell, that would sell right now. If you can come up with something about a woman of childbearing age traveling to South America, not being afraid of Zika, it will sell. I guarantee it, somebody will buy it. So you want to be timely. Why this? Why this subject? It's because of what everybody's talking about. Or it's why now? Because, well, the CDC is investigating Zika and coming up with this. And why you? Well, you happen to be a woman of childbearing age. So why this? Why now? Why you? It might be the great story. It might be the great time. But you may be the wrong person to tell it. And a lot of times your job is to convince the publisher or the editor that you are the right person to tell it, which is why you have to know what your strengths are. So always play off of your strengths, like I said, the hotel background, the food background, the luxury travel. And you should always build a backup pitch into any letter that you write when you're pitching. If you don't want to feature on Zika virus and women of childbearing age, how about something on, for the fun of book, about mosquito repellents, a short thing on mosquito repellent. It's also of the same topic. Or something like that. So you have a backup pitch built in. And if you're pitching a feature, also pitch something for front of book. And if you're pitching something for the front of book, come up with a second choice for the front of book. Make sense? Okay. Pitch 9 to 12 months in advance for magazines. It sounds really long. Online publications are a shorter lead time, but they still have a lead time of a few months because they have editorial calendars. Another term you need to know, editorial calendar, where they map out, well, April, we're going to do the pod issue because it's 420. Or May, we're going to do travel because it's spring. And June, we'll do whatever. Flowers, who knows. But they all have an editorial calendar. And you don't know that, and they're not going to tell you because they don't like necessarily to release that information. But you can look at magazines and know sort of what their editorial calendar is by what they're publishing this year. And if you're pitching 9 to 12 months out, go look at Condé Nast Traveler in June, and it's going to be about Europe. It usually is. So if you want to cover Europe, then you know that you're pitching for the June issue. So you say, I'd like to submit an idea for the June issue. Or, you know, you don't want to be vague. You don't want to say, hey, I have this great idea. I'm hoping to publish it. Because I won't. You have to let them know how you are helping them. You are here to help the editor. And if you have nothing to offer them except your own sparkling good looks, they're not going to call you. They're not going to write you back. So you're helping them. How are you helping them? What's your area of expertise? What's your strength? Make sure your contact information is right before you query an editor, because editors change all the time, and magazines particularly are always being relaunched and rebranded. And target your queries to a specific heading in the magazine. So if you want to write to San Francisco Magazine, you want to do something about weekends in Marin, then say, I'd like to suggest a piece for your weekender section. Again, know the magazine. Set yourself apart, know your talents, play off your strengths. If you're really obsessive, create an Excel spreadsheet with all the titles that you're interested in working for, or websites, or whatever it is, and know what they're doing when. And keep track of it, when to pitch, who covers what, like Condé Nast, Europe and summer. And a good little fun little exercise, go over here to the stacks in the magazines, go through 10 of them in 10 minutes, give yourself 1 minute with each magazine, and then when you get home, write 10 magazines, 10 minutes to review, and 10 minutes to write 10 pitches, 10 pitch ideas. Like, you don't have to elaborate, but just come up with the idea. It's good just to get things moving and how you might do this. Also, look at Media Bistro's webpage on pitching. Media Bistro, MediaBistro, two words. Media Bistro has a whole section, if you join them, you don't think you even have to pay, you just have to give them your email address, on how to pitch specific magazines title by title from a far travel magazine to Yahoo Auto. I looked today, A to Y. And it's in their career advice section. And if you're serious about freelancing and want to know the legal issues, buy a copy of Working for Yourself, Law and Taxes for Independent Contractors. NOLO Press, N-O-L-O. You know, there's a lot of different ways. I was going to talk about on the road. We only have about 5 minutes. I was going to say, you know, don't rely on your memory. Always take notes. If you're sitting and having a lovely meal, you'll forget it. You will forget everything. Either snap lots of pictures and use Evernote, or write longhand and keep moleskins. But you must make notes. Look beyond the obvious. At the Golden Gate Bridge, everybody's so busy looking at the towers and the cables, nobody notices there's a nude beach at the bottom of it. Or that if you go to the bottom and crawl through the fence that says do not trespass, you can walk around to where Kim Novak jumped in the water and... What's the film? What's the film? No. Vertigo. Don't rely on memory, see? Talk, and the other thing is if you're going to go out and explore and you're going to be on the road, find the maven, find the expert who knows things. There's always an expert. Find the expert. Don't trust anybody who says everything's great. If somebody says, this is good, this is good, this is good, oh, I love that place. Oh, that place is good too. Oh, that place. They're worthless. You want the people who are the discriminating intelligence. Get multiple stories out of one trip. If you go to Sonoma to do something about wine, also go to a cheese place and get something about cheese. Now you have to read any contract you get because sometimes publishers won't let you do that. So again, read any contracts. Fees, I won't talk about fees. The people who do best are really the ones who have a solid handle on their time and know how to stay out of debt. So don't go into this if you're debt prone and if you're a spendthrift and if you can't make small budgets work, because freelancing, and this is freelancing, is feast or famine. It's chicken or feathers. Website I told you, Media Bistro, there are local organizations like Left Coast Writers, Bay Area Travel Writers. And if you don't know how to make a website, you can look on Craigslist for people who work for cheap or just out of college, or go to your local school or somewhere where you have an affiliation, your alma mater. I don't know. It's San Francisco. You can make a website. Send thank you notes. This is so important in life in general, but especially with editing or anybody who helps you do this, helps you get anywhere in this field. You send a thank you note, not electronically. I mean, okay, you can send an email, but everybody gets so many freaking emails. Nice stationery and longhand, neat writing and a hand-addressed envelope, because everybody opens hand-addressed envelopes. They don't open stamp address, you know, the machine addressed. So if you send it, it will be opened and you will be remembered. So get nice stationery, have a card with your name on it. And a good book that you might want to consider getting is Don George's Travel Writing. He's one of the Lonely Planet's editors. And the book is called Travel Writing by Don George. And it's published by Lonely Planet. And it's probably the single best source I can think of for this topic that we've been talking about, I've been talking about for the last hour. You've been so gracious to listen so intently. And I think that's pretty much everything. You get back what you put into this, sort of. And remember what Molly Ivan said, the only thing harder than writing is coal mining. So, but if you want to do it, why shouldn't you? Just try. Just try. And you start. Start little. And see if it doesn't grow. So if there are any questions, I think we have a couple of minutes. Are there any questions? Please, go ahead. Oh, many. Fire. Oh, the second thing. Oh, yeah, the first thing is get up and write longhand. The other thing is once a week, take yourself someplace you wouldn't otherwise go that inspires in you creativity and imagination. And something you wouldn't otherwise do, and you do it alone. It's called an artist's date. So you take yourself out for 2 hours, you go climb a tree and write poetry, or you go something you wouldn't otherwise do that inspires creativity, and you go alone. Thank you for reminding me. Number two, you had, please go ahead.
If comps are the norm, do you have to like tell a
editor, publisher, if you're being comped from like...
Yes, if the editor does not bring up the question of comps, if they want you to go do something, you say, do you have a budget? If they say no, well, we work with the tourism authority.
So what if I'm actually, I have a trip that's being comped from a tourism group mm-hmm. that I'm pitching at, kind of like now and after the fact. So I'm pitching it...
Some publications will not accept your story. The Chronicle won't take it because Spud doesn't...
Because it's comped, so you would...
But only Spud. I mean, most people will take it.
It's... But you would include... Or are you like,
No. You just have the story. You have the story. You got the story. You made it work. But don't be a whore. Say this is for editorial consideration only. Not to suggest, but it's very important that you maintain your integrity is what I'm trying to say. Because there are a whole lot of people out there. You go to various, I won't say what famous travel writing group, but the definitive long-standing travel writing group. It's all these fat old people who just constantly just want to be flown here and fed this, and they just sit there and they sit on the van and they sit on the bus and they occasionally take a note. And that's old-style travel writing. That's dead. And those people are dying and that world is dying and you do not want to enter into that world. You will have to take comps, but you need to do it ethically and you need to be lean and need to say, I'm my own person, I'm my own mind. Know your own mind, keep your own counsel, and don't get confused. Yeah, the best will disclose if there's been a comp. And you should disclose if there's been a comp. Unless it's like a national park or something that, you can't make a bad hotel good, but it's good to disclose. That's the publisher's matter more than yours. Yeah. You had a question? Yes, please. Oh, no, they have very fancy contracts. They're very much contracted. But all those places, you know, a lot of that is... TV is a different matter. I was going to talk about TV and your demo reel, but don't worry about demo reels. Until just get the story part. Get the story and craft first. Yes, sir?
Can you talk a little bit about flogging?
About flogging? Oh. I can't really speak to that because I don't do it. It's not my thing. I mean, I can't really speak to it. I would really, you know, I'd point you to Michael Rosenblum and Lisa Lamden for their crash course in video journalism because their thing is very simple. You never move the camera. You have 5 frames. I won't tell you what they are because I signed a contract saying I wouldn't share, but it's a really simple way to shoot and edit. And if you have an extra $3,000 to go to New York and spend on this class, if you really want a career in this, it's a no-brainer. You have to take this class. Because soon other people will catch up, but people don't realize they have these broadcast quality cameras in their pockets. Nobody's putting it together. And so much bad video where the camera gets moved and, no, fix the camera. Don't move the goddamn camera. And make sure your frame is perfect and beautiful, but we digress. Any other questions? Yes, please.
What's going to happen to you? I mean, given that the world of travel publishing is contracting so terribly in Europe, when it's experts who's having their lips sawed out from underneath, how do you envision your own future 15 years from now?
I look really great on paper. And I've kind of done it. I feel like I've done it already. I don't want to go backwards. I don't want to keep doing what I've been doing. So I may move more into video, but I don't like TV people. I don't like their world, the TV world. I just don't like how their motivations are very venal and base. And I think I want to make big public art projects. That's what I want to do. I want to move in. I want to make big public art projects. I want to expand in art rather than sort of get smaller in technical ability. I want to do something bigger and broader. And because if you do well, if you have a really great Google profile, people look you up and they say, wow, what can I help you with? I say, well, funny you should ask. So you can establish, and this is the other thing of the power of the World Wide Web, is you're creating your own reputation. We all laughed when the teacher said, this will be on your permanent record, thinking there's no permanent record. And the joke is we're all making our own permanent records. So be careful what you put online. Any other questions? Did that answer your question? Did that help?
So that indicates that you want to move out of this field.
Well, because it's a field of diminishing returns. What's the first thing I said to you when I walked in the room? For those latecomers, there is no there, Gertrude Stein on Oakland. But it also applies to travel writing. There is no job as travel writer. It's gone. I mean, you can do it if you really work really hard and, like, why am I exhausting myself for $2 an hour? It's not worth it. So, but it can be fun and thrilling, and it can give you a great online profile, and people will say, wow, you're doing the thing I want to do. And then you get asked to speak at the library. yes, sir? Well, that's interesting. People don't really steal writing in the same way. You can kind of, it is technically, okay, anything you publish, if you really are worried about copyright, you put at the bottom copyright symbol with the year and your name. And that legally, it states copyright 2016, John Vlahides. And anytime I do anything, I don't know if it's on here, but it should be on here, I should have probably something else. You need a lawyer. Okay? If you're in video or television or anything, you know, everybody thinks you need an agent. You need an agent. You all know Ted Allen. He's on, what's that first? Chopped. He's the host of Chopped, and he used to be on Queer Eye for the Straight Guy. And he's a friend of a friend through a former publisher at Lonely Planet. And when I got this gig with National Geographic, I said, oh my God, do I need an agent? What do I do? And my publisher friend said, well, I'll ask Ted Allen that question. And he said, I'll put you two in touch. Here's his email address. So I wrote him a note. I said, should I get an agent? And he said, you don't need an agent. You need a lawyer. Ted. Good luck, Ted. And I wrote back, and I said, really, a lawyer sounds so expensive. And he wrote me, I don't want to offend anyone's sensibilities. But what he said was, oh, I shouldn't use this language at the library. Get a fucking lawyer. If you don't get a fucking lawyer, you're a stupid fucking idiot. I never fucking want to talk to you again because you're a stupid fuckhead. That's what he said to me, Ted Allen. And I quote, loosely, but that was the gist. And apologize, I'm so sorry, I've never in my dream, I apologize for offending anyone's sensibilities. It's inappropriate, but it's a quotation, so it's okay. So get a lawyer. If you have a contract, if you get your first contract and you want to take it to someone, call California Writers for the Arts, whatever. There are all sorts of, call the local bar association, and they all have pro bono time. It's part of the profession. So you can usually get someone's eye for half an hour to give you some direction. And then if you do get a gig that pays you well, and you're talking about $5,000, $10,000, $20,000, if you don't get a lawyer, then you are stupid. I won't call you what Ted called me, but he was right. It's the best thing I ever did was get a lawyer. So the lawyer told me, just put copyright, John Vlahides, 2015. Any other questions? One more, yeah? Two more?
Just on the blog, so you're suggesting to use your own name versus like another
catchy phrase that people may forget or may remember.
Exactly. But then what if your name is conducive to mistake and error misspelling, and do you have any issues with your name?
I mean, everybody misspells my name.
Right.
Everyone.
And I'm like, it's long.
But it's your name, and it's you're lucky to have a name that nobody can spell because it means that it's available as a URL. And it's the proper spelling of your proper name. So get it, and get it. Any other questions? Anything else? Well, thank you so much again to Brian Weaver, to the Public Library, and to all of you for coming out. I'm so grateful you did, and I've had a blast, and I hope you did too. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.